Greetings guys, this is Tokrav, and today I will be reviewing the WZ-131, the Chinese Tier 7 light tank. I'm going to run down everything you need to know about this tank, and I'm going to explain to you everything you need to know. This little light tank can have two different roles on the battlefield, and you do need to understand which role you need to make use of and why and when, and that's the hard part of being a light tank. This light tank is amazing for new players. It is a really good way to start and learn playing light tanks. So first of all, we're going to talk about the mobility of this tank. After that, we will be talking about the gun of this tank, and we will be running down the armor of this tank as well. And after that, I will be showing two replays, so that makes that the video can be a little longer than normal. I don't know if this video is going to be longer, we're going to see, but anyway, I do need to show those two replays because each of them highlight the role, the pivotal role that this tank has on the battlefield. So let's get started. First of all, the mobility of this tank, and light tanks are known for their extremely good mobility. So we're going to take a look at 60 km per hour top speed, which is a really good top speed limit in my opinion. This thing can really shift around the battlefield really quickly. The traverse speed is really high, 54 degrees a second. This tank will be able to turn very, very, very quickly. So what's next? The turret traverse is also really good. This thing will be turning a little bit slower its turret than the hull, of course, but it doesn't really matter. This thing is highly mobile and it will be shifting around the battlefield. Next up guys, we're going to take a look at the gun, and the WZ gets the choice of two guns. First of all, it gets the choice at the best gun is an 85mm or a 100mm. So let's combine and see what we can see about from the stats. As we can see, let's first cover the 85mm. The 85mm has got a really high rate of fire. It's got 159mm of penetration. It has got 200 alpha damage, 0.36 accuracy, 0.27 aim time. A very good quick handling gun. And now we're taking a look at the 100mm, which has a 6.9 rounds a minute, which is pretty low. A good penetration of 181, a good alpha damage of 250, but for the penetration and the average damage, it loses all of its accuracy. Yeah, not all of it, but it loses a lot, 0.38 accuracy, and it loses a lot of aim time, going down to 2.7. In my opinion, but that depends on your playstyle, I would rather choose the 85mm. You'll be able to get a lot of more shots off than normal. You will be able to put them in more consistently, and I didn't really have a problem with the 20mm less of penetration. As you can see, I've got two marks of excellence on my tank, so I really know how to drive this thing. In my opinion, the 85mm is the way to go, but if you prefer to have more alpha damage and more penetration but lose accuracy and aim time and think that is worth it, then the 100mm will be your gun. But for now, I'm going to be reviewing the 85mm. The 85mm, let's put him up again, let's look at the gun stats again. So as I said, the rate of fire is really good, giving you a really quick reload time of 5.2 seconds, which is really good in my opinion. Penetration is alright. Comparing it to its other tier 7 counterparts, the Walker Bulldog is 175, which is a bit below average. The 1375 has got a 144, I think. So comparing it with its counterparts, it does not have the best penetration, but I have to say it's quite about average. You can I hadn't had any problems with this penetration at all. The penetration is really usable in my opinion. Alpha damage is not that high either, but the quick rate of fire makes up for it. You can really pepper your enemy tanks really quickly in this tank, in my opinion. I'm not that guy that goes for alpha damage, I'm that guy that goes for DPM. I love DPM a lot more than a high alpha damage. The yeah, accuracy is alright, it could be a lot better, but 0.36 is not the least accurate you can ever get. I think 0.36 is pretty good accuracy. Aim time of 2.3 seconds is also alright. So that gets me to the conclusion. I think the stats of this gun are alright, but I think on the battlefield this gun is very easily and good usable, especially for a player that knows what he's doing. But you really do need to play the tank a lot more to know what to expect from this gun. If you mount the 100mm, all those expected things of the gun will be a lot less expected. That might sound really confusing, but it just means that the gun will be a lot less reliable, of course, to put in shots into tanks. And I do prefer reliability of the gun, even if that loses me a little bit of alpha damage and penetration, but I think that is far more worth it. So in my opinion, the 85mm is the way to go. And I have to say, this is quite an average gun. It's not the best gun you can have, it's not the worst gun you can have, but it's a very good average gun. So for the armor, guys, I don't really need to put us into Tank Inspector, because this light tank might be highly mobile, but it loses all of its armor pretty much. This thing has got no armor whatsoever, so that means getting hit will always penetrate. Most likely, instead, if they hit the gun, that will sometimes pull off a bounce. I had some bounces on the really, really, really well angled sides of this turret, as you can see, but it is really hard to pull off a bounce in this tank. Even side scraping is no option at all. Almost every gun will over penetrate your armor, and that just means that when a gun has got triple the caliber of the amount of armor it is shooting at, then the gun will automatically penetrate. So it's an auto pen for almost all the guns, aside and the rear. So let's take a look. Front is 35mm, the side and rear are only 20mm. The turret is a little bit thickly armored, but still no armor at all. 45mm on the front, 35 on the side, and 20 at the rear. So this thing doesn't have any armor at all. And that also means that it doesn't really matter what it gets shot at. It can get shot at by a tier 6 tank and it will still penetrate, or it can get shot at by a tier 10 tank and it will still penetrate. The only thing that you need to take account of is that you don't, of course, want to be you don't want to get hit by tier 10 tanks who have a lot more alpha damage than a tier 6 tank. So it really depends from who you want to get shot off and who you want not. But the best way to do this is to avoid all enemy contact and avoid getting shot from, yeah, try everyone. So that means that this vehicle gets a supporting role on the battlefield. This thing can't go in the front lines, because if it goes in the front lines, it will just get shot and destroyed very quickly indeed. So this is a support tank. Most of the light tanks, of course, are support tanks, but if you see an opportunity with an enemy on his own, you can just go in and make use of that, and we will see some of those opportunities in the replays as well. People try to fight enemies who are just hopeless and can't do anything about you attacking them. Another important thing about light tanks is, of course, that it is trying to help its allies by spotting the enemy tanks. And I see a lot of players on teams with maybe a light tank who is in their base, and then team players get really pissed off because the light tanks aren't spotting. And at some situations you just can't. Even though you might be one of the only tanks alive on your team, it is still not a smart thing to go and spot, because this thing has no armor at all, of course, and you just can't fight on the front line. So if you might be 2 versus 5, let's say 5 enemy tanks are left alive and you are alive with maybe a Yak Tiger on your team, the tier 9 German tank destroyer, that Yak Tiger has to go first because he has the most armor and he can take shots. You just can't take shots at all. You might go and spot off, try to make some spots, but yeah, it is really risky, of course. This thing has no armor at all. So I just can't stand people who just think that light tanks always need to be spotting for the team, but that is not true. Light tanks need to support the team and help wherever they can. And yeah, if you do play light tanks, well, you can get really good stats in World of Tanks. But if you play light tanks horribly, your stats will just plummet. But anyway, what is important about a light tank? View range. So we're going to take a view range. The base view range of this tank is 390, which is pretty average, I guess. There are tanks themselves that have 400 meter standard, but it doesn't really matter. So I choose to make this tank have more view range. You can do that by putting consumables on it, as you can see down here. You can get optics or binoculars, and the main difference between optics and binoculars is the stationary thing. Binos will only work if you are stationary for a few seconds and then the binos will pop on. Let's say they will turn green in your game and then you will see that your binos are activated. With optics, that is not the case. Optics will give you 10% extra view range, but they will give you 10% while driving and while being stationary. Binoculars only give you 25% plus view range, but only if you are stationary and you need to activate them by standing still for a few seconds. So that is the main difference between optics and binoculars. I choose to use binoculars on this tank because the Chinese light tanks are also very commonly known for their sneakiness, as they call it. These tanks can be really sneaky. I've got really high camo rating, and that is because I've also mounted a camo net on this tank, and I have started a camo crew train up, as you can see here. If this skill is fully up, then I will of course choose the Brothers in Arms skill. That will also increase my camo rating a bit, but this camo net will also activate when I will be stationary for a few seconds. So then I will have the extra camo rating of this camo net. I will have the stationary camo rating of the tank itself, and I will be having the camo rating of my crew, which makes the camo rating of this thing just insane. But if you fire, even if you are standing behind a double boost, sometimes you will still get spotted. But that is the trick. Don't fire if you're standing behind a boost. But I will also cover that when we are taking a look at the replay. But for the rest, what you need to know, what is also special about light tanks is their camo rating, how it works. Light tanks will have got the same camo rating when they drive as when they are stationary. That is a really big advantage for every light tank. For instance, if I'm driving the IS-2, for instance, this thing will only have the highest camo rating if it is stationary, but if it starts driving, then its camo rating will just plummet. And that is not the case with light tanks. Light tanks will have the same camo rating as they drive as when they are stationary, which is a really good example, of course. So I think I need to cover now how you need to drive this thing on the battlefield and what the pivotal role of this little light tank can be on the battlefield. So let's go and take a look at the gameplay. So guys, here we go on the map, Muromvanka. I am driving the WZ-131, and now we're going to talk about the two ways you can play this tank. You can be a spotter or you can be a fighter. But how do I know when I do need to do what? Well, that all comes down to experience in the first place. You need to know when is a time to attack and when is a time to help the team by spotting them. But if you can get on a map like Muromvanka, then of course it is pretty logical that you would go spotting for the team. So that is exactly what I've done. I've parked myself right in front of a bush, really weird bounce there. That has to be a blind fire. My sixth sense didn't go off because I've got sixth sense on this tank. So that was a bit weird. But anyway, let's focus up on the gameplay. I was standing right in a bush here with my camo net and my binoculars activated. So without the enemy coming too close to me, I shouldn't get spotted at all. Instead, if I fire, well, now I'm going to explain some bush mechanics now. If you are in a light tank and you stand inside a bush and the enemy isn't 50 meters away from you, and I will feature that a little bit later, but it will also be featured, you will not get spotted. But if you fire, you will get spotted. So I fire here and I do get spotted, as you can see. So that is a perfect timing. That is something that I shouldn't have done because I was too greedy for damage at that moment, but I should have just stayed in that bush. But now I'm unspotted and I'm going to park myself right back into that bush, activate my binoculars and camo net again. So I shouldn't get spotted without firing again. So what I'm doing now, I'm just providing the best view range I can for my team. Well, now, there is a possibility that you can fire through a bush without getting spotted, and that is the double bush mechanic, or you can just do that by driving back behind the bush at least 50 meters until you cannot see through it again and then fire. But that is something that is not a possibility at this moment because I am right at the open field, so I can't really take the risk of firing at the moment. So we won't probably watch the whole of this replay, but I just want to explain to you how you can play the spotting role the best. And of course, the pro tip is use bushes, of course. Don't make a YOLO run through the map, because that won't work. Because now, take attention, that French tank is just driving right here, and I am really cautious here because I do not want to get spotted. I spotted him and he did not spot me from that distance. And that is because the Chinese light tanks have got really good camo rating. They are very sneaky tanks. So the Chinese are very good for spotting as for fighting, but you will see that a little bit later in the replay. Take a shot there at the low, it was a very bad mistake. As you could see, I got spotted, my gunner got taken out, and it lost me a lot of hit points. So I'm driving around here to make sure that I'm unspotted, and then I'm going back into the bush again. So we are winning this game all the way, as you can see, but I do need to spot more, so I'm going to go in a bush here a little bit more towards the enemy. Or it is the same bush, I could be mistaken here. No, it's a bush further, but anyway, I do have to be careful because there's another mechanism that will spot you automatically, and that is proxy spotting. When an enemy tank is 50 meters away in World of Tanks standards, then you will automatically get spotted whatever you do, and even if there is a house between you and the enemy, you will still get spotted. So that's something you need to take note of. Ooh, I fire here. I do get spotted again, as you can see. So firing in this bush is really, really, really dangerous, and you should never do this. But it looks like I was very, very greedy for damage at that moment. But trust me, guys, don't fire in a bush, especially if you can look through it. If you want to fire and have the highest chance of not getting spotted, go behind the bush 50 meters until you can never not see through it anymore, and then fire. Well, now I can see that this KV-4 is going forward, so I'm going forward with him as well, because there is no point in spotting behind my allied lines, so to speak. If an ally is in front of me, then there's no use of keeping back to try and spot from there. So I'm going to go forwards with this KV-4. I'm going to help where I can. There's a Walker Bulldog there. He's a very valuable tank for the enemy team, so it would be nice to kill him, and I do. Good kill. So now I'm going forward again, and I'm pretty sure that I can go forwards now, because as you can see behind me on the map, all of my allies have conquered the middle pretty much, so I'm pretty sure that I won't get slammed in the back from any unexpected enemy. And now that that Walker Bulldog is dead, I'm pretty confident that I can just go to town on these guys. And now is the time to fight. As you can see, the spotting is over. It's time to clean up. Let's put some good shots into this Jagdpanther. Oh, the 12T was standing in the bushes there. And he remained unspotted until he fired. So that's another bush mechanic, for you there. Let's see if we can make some other good shots happen. Let's kill this guy, hopefully. Can we kill him? Good stuff. And now that Yak Panther is there, also have a shot on him, see if we can kill him. Good stuff. Only two enemy tanks remaining, and this is going to take a while, so I think I'm going to cut off the replay right here, because I won't be able to get that much out of this replay anymore. But anyway, hopefully I showed you what a spotter needs to do. In the next replay, we are going to feature the fighter, when you need to be a fighter and how that looks like in a light tank. But for now, let's take a look at the post-game stats of this game before we go into the second replay. First of all, I need to say that I never expected the results that popped up on my screen when I finished this game. I got an Ace Tanker badge, a spotter medal, a fighter of a spotter token, a fighter token, a duelist token, a fire for effect token, and I got the patrol duty medal. And the spotter token and the patrol duty medal should have told me enough that I had done a lot of spotting in this game. So let's take a look how much I did. In this game, I did 4,270 spotting damage in total, or at least assistance damage. And I didn't do that much normal damage either. I only did 1,446 damage. But that amount of spotting damage is what got me the experience, as you can see. 1,346 base experience. And with me not having to do a lot of damage, I still picked up the Ace Tanker. So this replay gave a perfect example of what a spotter needs to do. A spotter needs to assist the team by trying to spot the enemy team without risking its own life. So right now, let's take a look at the second replay. So guys, the second match we are going to be watching of the WZ-131 is a match on the map Ensk. And as you guys know, Ensk isn't the best map to go spot on. Because on the left, most of the time, all the tank destroyers will be trying to camp, and it's just a camp out on the eastern side, and the west is the city, where you wouldn't be able to spot at all. So this is a map where fighting is going to be the primary thing. But first of all, I can always try to get off some spots, so that's why I am putting up my binoculars and my camo net here, to try if I can maybe get some spots off. But doesn't seem like it, because my platoon mate is also trying to put spots off here, and he's even closer, and that 1390 is also trying to spot off. So I'm going to realize that, well, spotting this position doesn't really going to do for a lot for me. But I'm just looking at the map now and thinking, okay, what's the enemy team planned out for this game? Okay, and I think, okay, let's just go, because spotting isn't going to help me out a lot. So trying to maybe get some shots off on people that might be crossing. Nobody gets spotted, unfortunately. So I'm just waiting here if I maybe get an opportunity. Doesn't look like it. So maybe I could put a shot into one of those tanks back there. No idea what this Waffenträger Panzer IV is doing, but this is a pretty horrible map for him as well. I get spotted, but I managed to get a shot off and kill the VK. So that's one of their scouts dealt with. No idea again what this Waffenträger of Panzer IV is doing. Oh well. I'm not driving that tank at the moment, so I wouldn't bother with it. So, okay, one shot so far. Yeah, see, there's one guy crossing. I needed to fire clutch there. Wasn't really well aimed, but I didn't really have a lot of time to place that shot really well. But now I can see an IS there. My platoon mate has already seen him. Going to put a shot into him. And everybody's just unloading on this IS. And my platoon mate is going ham on him. Perfect light tank play there. This is one of those opportunities where you just have to go in and kill the tank. And his autoloader is a really advantage for that. Really big advantage. So now I can see that pretty much nobody of the enemy team has gone towards the city side, because the Waffenträger of Panzer IV has almost crossed the whole of this city part without spotting any enemy. Yeah, there's one RU there, but that means that most of the enemy will be at the eastern side of this map. So killing the RU there. Let's see if I can support some more. Well, now this is the place where I'm going to meet up a lot of enemies. And I do have to be careful here, because it is very likely that I will have to fight the enemy front on, and that is something that I don't want to do. Well, now this 1319 is trying to flank, and I of course don't want that to happen. If he manages to flank my team, we will be in a lot of trouble. So I'm just chasing after this guy. We need to kill him. He gets tricked. Good stuff. I put a shot in, and he's dead. I wouldn't have rather rammed him to death, but I would have stopped in front of him if he had still lived and take him out with a shot, because I don't want to lose any health by ramming an light tank. That's just wasted health. But now we are going to have to fight the enemy head on. I'm going to see how the engagement develops. If I can see that this engagement isn't going to go well for this tank, then I have to, of course, try and do something else. But now I'm just going to support my team. This Black Prince has a quick rate of fire, but he just got shot at. He just fired, I put a shot into him, I pull back. He's on 25 island, and I think, oh, he fired again. Put a shot in, but it bounces. But he gets taken out anyway. So now, as we can see, all of the enemy team are back here. So let's see if we can get a shot off on the KV-3. A little bit struggling with these pillars here. Bad shot there through the rubble there. Didn't really have a choice. He puts a shot into me, I put a shot into him, and I set him on fire. So I think my shell hurts a little bit more, Mr. KB3. My shot hurts a little bit more. Well, now, let's see if I can put a shot into this guy, maybe, because the KB3 certainly is going to peek out. Oh, he does. So quickly get behind this cover here. And then I realize, okay, this might be a bit dangerous. But anyway, okay, let's just get in. Let's go in. We need to kill some tanks because we are one tank less. So I'm going to kill this guy. That's one kill. I can see the side of the T-32 there. I'm going to put a shot into him quickly. He bounces on me. He should have hit the very good angled sidearm of my turret. Prototype is coming in. Quickly put a shot into him and pull back. Good stuff so far. It's very likely that he is angled, and he did. So I'm going to track that prototype in place. And now I have to get out of here, because now the enemy team for certain know that I am here. And they will of course all be pre-aiming for me. So let's try to help my platoon mate out with this Centurion. Let's kill him. Good stuff. He's down. And now I can focus my attention again on those guys back there. See if I can put a shot in. I'm really hoping that I can put a shot into the Leopard PTA, because he's a good player. Also need to watch out for the Type 61. Oh, there's the Leopard. Good stuff. Quickly put a shot into him, because that tank doesn't have a lot of armor anyway, so quickly dealt with. I do get hit there, really weird. And this is a really bad engagement for this tank. Front on, I'm going to make a mistake now. I think that the prototype is fired, but he didn't. That actually was the T-32 who fired at me. Well, no, I had loaded a heat round with 230mm of penetration. Forgot to mention that, the penetration of the heat round. But it's a really good heat penetration anyway. Lost a lot of health, and I don't have any health to take any more shots. And I'm thinking that the prototype is chasing me. So what I'm doing now, I'm thinking, okay, I need to get out of here. I don't want the prototype to come after me and finish me off. Me and my platoon mate really need to carry this game if we want to win. So my platoon mate catches him with his side armor, and he puts some good shots into the prototype. I'm thinking, okay, I know that the prototype hasn't flank route, so this position is safe for me again. But then the Type 61 gets spotted, and he's going after my platoon mate. I really need to start and help my platoon mate out. I think that was a reticule bug or something, but my shot totally misses. But I quickly have to help my platoon mate because he's going to die. Oh, very good save there. If I hadn't done that on time, then the Type 61 would have killed my platoon mate. And it would have been really hard for me to try and kill the remaining prototype. But anyway, this game is won now. There's nothing that this prototype can do. He puts a shot in, and Batube puts a shot in. So let's take a look at the post-game stats of this game. What a game this was. In this game, I got an Ace Tanker badge, as well as the previous replay we watched, I got a Fire for Effect token and a Bruiser token. And for my 6 skills, I of course got a Top Gun medal, something that is a really good and big achievement in a light tank, getting a Top Gun medal. And I also got the Confederate medal because I was helping wherever I could to finish this game and try to help my team wherever I could. In this game, I got 1675 experience and I got 34,000 credits earned. If we have a look at the team scores now, we can see that I did 3573 damage, which is a really good amount of damage for a tier 7 light tank. I made 6 kills, giving me the Top Gun medal, with 1675 base experience, which is a really high amount of base experience. And as you can see, my platoon mate finished second and he also did really well. But it looks like I ended up second on damage because the Waffenträger of Panzer IV on my team did 1 damage more than I did. God damn. Nah, anyway, I did very well in this game. In this game, I fired 26 shots, of which 20 hit and 70 penetrated, doing the total of 3573 damage. And that's pretty much all I did this game. I tried to fight wherever I could and where my team needed my help. I didn't spot. I did 23 assistance damage, but that's probably not from spotting. And I blocked 1 shot from the T-32, probably on the very good angled side of my turret. But the main focus of this replay was being a fighter in a light tank. So now pretty much we have come towards the end of this video, and I do have to say that how do you know that you need to be a spotter or a fighter? That all comes down to experience. Just as I said at the beginning when we start watching the replays, just play light tanks more and you will, by experience, learn when you need to be the spotter or when you need to be the fighter. So guys, this was the review of the WZ-131, the Chinese tier 7 light tank, an absolute beast of a light tank as you could see. Hopefully you've enjoyed this review, and please consider leaving a like down below, because I did put a lot of time in making this video. Do you guys have any idea how long it takes to make such a video? The recording itself doesn't take that long, but the editing is just insane. Especially those parts in the beginning of the replay where I put down all of the stats and organize them in good, bad or average. That just takes so much time, so I would really appreciate you guys leaving a like, and let me know in the comments what you think about this video maybe, or if you want to share your opinion about the WZ-131. Maybe you have something else to say in the comments below, and please make sure you subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you want to see another very good game of me playing the WZ-131, there is another video on my channel called the WZ-131 Bombs It Round. And in that video, I will be getting 5,000 damage in a light tank, and I will just miss out on 8 kills. So if you are interested, go and check out that video. But for now, that's everything. Hopefully you like this video, and I will see you guys in the next one. Bye.